decision to make a solo performance instead of a group show?
Well, there's many simple answers and many complicated answers for that, but I have been doing this for 40 years and I have been making solo work for the last, I think it's 10 years actually. But when I first started out, I had a trio in the 80s when I first started, and then I went solo, and then I had a company, and really touring a large company is an expensive business. But the truth of the matter is, really, I like being on stage by myself. I don't want any more competition. I don't want anyone competing with me in there. Why would I want that? And I am able to say what I need to say by myself. And I'm happy. I'm really happy on the stage alone, because I think it's a partnership with the audience anyway. So I feel that, you know, as a performer, I'm addressing the audience and we're kind of in this place together. So I don't feel isolated in any way, shape or form. I actually prefer, I really like working alone, it suits me. That's really bottom of the thing.
What's been the biggest challenge you've had to face in regards to tonight's show?
Biggest challenge. Well, the biggest challenge facing me at the moment is this show has been very popular. So I'm now quite a mature artist, as you can tell, and I've done sort of 52 shows back to back, and they're still going on. And the biggest thing as a mature artist is finding a way to conserve your energy as a soloist, because you're out there by yourself and you're having to hold the space alone. So that's a big challenge. And I've come off a tour where I did Budapest and Holland, and it was three shows in two countries in 4 days. And that is really exhausting. I think even for a young person, it's exhausting. So I came out of that like this. And I had to have a holiday after that.
Yeah.
And now I've come back into this. And I think those are the challenges. It's how you maintain your level of fitness, your level of ambition with the work, your ability to always see it as every time you perform, you're performing it in a new kind of way. You have to accept that, I mean, that's how I work this piece, that it's to make it fresh and new every time, because when you're performing so regularly with something, it can seem like, well, you never want it to just become any old job.
Yeah.
It has to be fresh and new, and that requires a huge amount of energy and managing the adrenaline and all the whole thing that goes through it. And yeah, it's that really more than anything else. But apart from that, it's fine.
Good. You talk about being seen and not heard as a child. Would you say that your childhood has shaped your career?
Well, you know, I think that when you first start out in performance, you have big ideas about what it is you want to make work about, and you don't think that your background or your autobiographical background has anything to do with actually the stage space, but it really does. And my background has been very important in sort of framing the way I make work, because I am really interested in the kind of the politics, the history, and the economic time that I grew up in. So I was born in 1953, which was, you know, my parents were a post-war generation, and there were all the stresses and strains, and the kind of world that I grew up in was a world where we had nothing. You live in a different world now.
Yeah.
It's a digital age, you have everything, you know, in fact you have too much, but, you know, I lived in a world and a culture where no was the answer to everything. You know, there was no money, there wasn't anything to buy. I mean, rationing had only just finished, I think, in 1952. So it's a completely different way of understanding that. And so a lot of what interests me is how that history is carried on the body and how you bring that history into a sort of contemporary world. So for me, although, you know, I do make reference to my past history, and I do make reference to myself as myself as a child, and as an adult, but all the references I make are actually quite global. What is interesting about this piece is that it's become very interesting for a whole range of people who see it, from young people who may not understand the detail of the references, but they understand the context and the way I'm talking. And from a feminist perspective, of course, you know, I grew up in a time where, you know, women were seen. As a little girl, I was definitely seen and not heard, you know. Little girls were seen and not heard. You know, shh, be quiet, behave yourself, sit still, stop it. No, you can't. It was, you know, it's a whole different culture now. And as I've got older, of course, I want to be as visible as I possibly can be. And for me, you know, this whole piece is a, you know, it's a feminist statement about representation of the older female, but it's also a representation of women. It's giving women permission to say and do and be as they wish to be, because this piece is quite anarchic in that way. It demands attention, and it requests that you know, you as a woman can, you know, you can do whatever it is you want, really. You don't have to be, you know, have somebody say, shh, be quiet, stop it. So it's my voice, and I hope my voice is an empowering voice for female audiences, or for audiences generally, especially for audiences who are, you know, like here tonight, there'll be students who are looking to make work. Mm-hmm. And I think it's really important for students to see a kind of range, a broad range of dance, performance, theatre, dance theatre, whatever you want to call it, I don't know, I call it performance. But it's, for me, it's really important that they see this, that they don't think it's just one thing. Mm. The discipline of dance is very broad, and it embraces a huge range of very interesting ideas. And it is such a possibility to work, as I do, with text, I work with film, I work with, you know, soundscapes. I work with a broad range of ideas, and dance can actually, it's a very inclusive art form in that way. It can really engage with all those different disciplines, and that's what makes it exciting for me.
Don't like it? Get rid of it. Don't like it? Get another one. Don't like it? Get over it.
What was the process for creating this piece, and is there anything about it you would change?
The process for creating this piece. God, you see, I made this piece, I have to remember now, because when I made it when I was 63, so I'm 65 now. Did I make it 63? Anyway, I'm 65 now. I've been doing it for 3 years, so I made it when I was 64. Mm-hmm. Is that right? Yes, I think so. I can't remember. So, I when I make work, it's a long process for me, and that's something I think that students probably don't understand. You know, when you're studying dance, as I did all those years ago, you make quick tasks, quick response, week by week, da da da, because you have to build up your language, you have to build up your ability to create movement language, your ability to learn how to perform. You need to, you know, you make fast tasking work. But the last three pieces that I've made have taken a year to make. Mm-hmm. This piece took a year to make. And the research was, it's a process that I really like doing. And, you know, I spend 3 months at least just reading, looking at other material, mm-hmm. spending a lot of time in archives, drawing, collecting. I like collect for my museum. Mm-hmm. It's my museum I'm creating. And that process then leads me into other aspects of the making of the piece. And it's a very satisfying process for me. I like spending a long time, you know. I think a lot of people think that you can just bash out a dance piece in, or bash out a performance in 2 weeks. And, you know, it isn't quite as simple as that. And for me, as I've got older, I've really enjoyed spending more and more time on creating the work. It's the research and the process is as important for me as the final, creating the final work. So yeah, I wouldn't change anything. And in fact, I am making a new piece of work starting in January, and it will take me 1 year to make. Mm-hmm. and I don't intend to change that.
Here comes the music, so off we go again. That's it, pass the balloon.
And our last question is, how do you want the audience to feel after they leave your show?
Oh, absolutely empowered. And I want them to feel that they've been given permission to get on with their own lives and feel good about what it is they want to do, and feel confident as well that they should be able to do what they want to do. I want them to have had a good time. It's a very accessible piece. It's very funny as well as very dark at the same time. There's a sort of darkness in there. But I hope that they will have been stimulated and challenged to think about the nature of performance, challenged to think about the compositional structure of work, challenged to think about, is it possible to be an older artist and a successful one? Is it possible, you know, of course, you know, I want them to feel empowered from all those questions. So it's a challenge for them, and I hope that they take up the challenge.
Great, thank you. I look forward to seeing the show.